Hey, Jen, you know, we've been taking these supplements for a few months now. They're called Essentials by Revival. They've helped us tremendously, from better sleep to mental clarity, because these supplements were formulated by women. They actually do what they say.
Yes, and they're made with the highest quality ingredients combined in a way that supports the changing needs of our bodies. I've stopped taking everything else because these are all the vitamins, minerals, and herbs that I need. And because the bottles are color-coded for morning, midday, and bedtime, it's so easy to follow, so you always know when to take them.
Isn't it great to have a one-stop shop for all your vitamin needs?
Yes, and if you want to simplify and get maximum benefits from your supplements, check out Essentials by Revival at revival.com/shop and use code EBT20 for 20% off your purchase.
So join us for all these benefits and more. Try Essentials today.
Money is not a state of mind. It's this thing that we then have a relationship with, and it's that relationship that creates fear and anxiety and all these emotions. And so when you're afraid of money, you're really afraid of your association with it, your understanding of it, the way you talk to it, the way it talks to you. And so much of what we learn is rooted in our childhood.
Hey everybody, this is Lori Schulweis.
And I'm Jen Giamo.
And welcome to another episode of Every.Body Talks, the podcast where we explore the wide world of wellness. Sometimes we talk to experts, sometimes we just talk to each other, but we're always talking to you.
Every week we discuss topics from nutrition and exercise to mindfulness and self-care. And today we're talking about financial health and getting over your fears around money.
Let's get started.
She is one of America's leading personal finance authorities. She's a multi-best-selling financial author, former CNBC host, and creator of the Webby-nominated podcast, So Money. I love that name. She has become one of the country's favorite go-to money experts.
The New York Times calls her advice perfectly practical, and we're going to talk with her today about all things financial health to two people who need that. Mm-hmm. And also, her new book is out now, A Healthy State of Panic. Please welcome Farnoosh Torabi. Farnoosh, welcome so much. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So happy to have you
here. I know.
Okay, we're going to get right in. I want you to tell us more about yourself, because we really kind of gave a very brief overview, and how you got interested in personal finance.
Well, I dreamt about it growing up as a young girl. I mean, my first love was the New Kids on the Block. Second love, compound interest. I think I grew up the daughter of Iranian immigrants in Worcester, Massachusetts in the 1980s. And yeah, I can get into like, I went to school for finance and I went to school for journalism. And, you know, there's that sort of story of working in personal finance media. But I think the real source of this, of who I became and why I became who I became, is because I grew up with a really unique childhood. I think the perspectives, the life perspectives that my parents shared with me were important. They came from Iran, which is a war-torn country. It was then, it still is. And I think they came here, like a lot of immigrants, terrified, but also very, very hopeful. And that was like the combination, the cocktail that I was raised with was like, you know, shoot for the stars. Life is abundant, but also be terrified because things can also turn and unexpectedly and nothing is predictable. And so having both of those sensibilities was everything I use and apply in my financial life. Like you have to some extent, be comfortable with risk, but have a plan. And spend within your means and use a lot of practicality, but also take some chances. And along the way, my parents, I think this is cultural. It's not cultural in America, I would say, but definitely within the Middle Eastern culture and definitely within my family where we talk about money. And it's not like we sit down and we talk about investing and we have these like tutorials, but it's just that there's a comfort level talking about money where it's just not there in a lot of other households, right? We didn't talk about maybe things like sports, but we talked about real estate. We talked about my dad would come home and be very transparent about the layoffs at work. And I remember being 8 or 9 years old and listening to these conversations and not maybe even knowing all of what was really going on, but hearing through his voice a little bit of the fear and concern. And then I also heard my parents argue about money a lot, which I don't recommend as a way to train your kids to become financially vigilant. But honestly, it was the sort of exposure that what I ultimately learned from that, hearing them battle around, you know, things like, how much are we going to spend on this? My mother didn't really work for a lot of her years raising us. And so there was this power dynamic. My dad made all the money. And so she was always in this position of having to ask for it. And like, that was difficult. And I think what I learned from that is, especially as a woman, it's important to grow up and make your own money and not be dependent to the extent that you can on anybody else. And so that was a bit of a, maybe an unexpected twist, where maybe someone growing up with a lot of fist banging on kitchen tables and arguments around money would have a terrible idea of like what it means to work through your financial issues. But it kind of inspired me.
That's amazing. I mean,
I know.
I always think, like, when I was reading your book and I was trying to like think back to my childhood and how I grew up, and obviously growing up in America, it is very different, and you don't talk about, no one really talked about
money.
No
one talks about money.
Kind of perceived as like, it's rude. Don't ask, rude, don't talk about that. It's rude, you know? But I can remember, like, and we'll get into this a little bit more when we talk about fear, but like, there was always this, my dad would always talk about other people and like how much money so-and-so made, or how much, wouldn't you say, or how successful they were. And that always in my mind equated to, they must've made a lot of money. You know, it was always like, this person's so successful and this person did, and everything was like, work hard and do this. And, you know, it all tied back to making enough money, and being successful meant making enough money, you know, and that's kind of what I,
that's definitely your mentality now. Like, you equate success with making a lot of money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's a lot of people. That's, we live in a capitalist world. That's the first thing we learn is that, if you want to be successful, you have to make money, make a lot of it. We put people on covers of magazines for making a lot of money. At the same time, it's really interesting. We glorify the rich and we also villainize them.
Yes.
We don't talk favorably about people who are too rich, right? You know, like, people we think that are focused on making a lot of money have their values messed up, or they're not, you know, they're not nice people or kind people. How could they possibly be if like they care so much about money? And yet we also like put, you know, billionaires on the covers of magazines. And so I think there's a lot of confusion around what we're supposed to think about money growing up, and even still. And then add to that, that we don't even like allow ourselves the space to talk about it, to sort of like work through these like confusing concepts. It ends up, you become an adult who's finally making a paycheck and you're not really sure how to talk about it.
What to do about it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was going to say, we recently, my father grew up very, very poor. And we recently kind of cornered him into giving us like a little lesson about his childhood, because we really hadn't done that. I mean, we had some sense of it, but he used to wear a coat into a department store, take it off, and that's how he got a new coat. Like, he would essentially take a new one and wear it out. So that when he became a huge success, like, we weren't, those kind of values, I feel, were not instilled in us, you know, like, I don't, that's why I think I'm kind of screwed up, like, because I think, like, well, there'll always be money, it always will appear, you know, somehow, because I think it always did, and still does, I think, in a lot of ways, you know.
Yeah, your childhood, I mean, it's the predicting model, like, it's gonna tell you what, you know, and not to say that you're doomed, like, there's no way to unwrite these narratives, or, but it takes recognizing, you know, how you were raised. And if you're afraid of money, which I talk about in the book, the fear of money is central to the book, as well as other fears, but the fear of money is, it's funny because it's not like some of these other fears that I talk about in the book, like the fear of loneliness, the fear of rejection, the fear of failure. Money is not a state of mind. It's this thing that we then have a relationship with, and it's that relationship that creates fear and anxiety and all these emotions. And so when you're afraid of money, you're really afraid of your association with it, your understanding of it, the way you talk to it, the way it talks to you. And so much of what we learn is rooted in our childhood. And again, it's not because our parents told us anything specific. It's how they modeled and the way we were raised. And I mean, now as a parent, I'm really trying to be more conscious of that. And what are the, I mean, it's a constant balance. Like, on the one hand, I want to provide for my kids because that's what I work hard to do. You know, that's the whole point, is to make sure that they're comfortable and we're all comfortable. But when is it too far? When are you taking it too far? I think, again, my parents raised me with everything that I needed. And also this understanding that you got to take care of yourself because no one else will take care of yourself better than you.
Exactly.
You have to be your biggest advocate. Like, we love you, but success is not coming back to live with us after college.
Right.
Forever.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I guess, as I'm saying this out loud, I'm like, a lot of kids are living it. That's not to say that that's a bad thing, but that you need to have a plan. Like, sometimes living at home is actually wise because you go home and you get to save more. And then in 5 years, you can leapfrog because you've got, all that money in the bank. So you got to take advantage of that, you know, be smart about it.
Okay, I want to go back for a second about this fear of money, because this is something that, I mean, I read it in your book and I've heard people talk about it and I don't understand it. Like, I am welcoming if money fell out of the sky right now, my arms would be open. I am not afraid of it. I am like,
I think we're all you. I think we're all you in that.
But what does it mean? What does it mean?
So it's not like we actually, like, I'm holding up my credit card here. Like, I love it. You know, I'm going to. It's more like what it represents, and it's within our financial lives. There are these aspects that terrify us. It's the decisions that we have to make that involve money, the choices, because your financial life is just full of trade-offs. You buy one thing, it means you're not going to be able to buy something else. Money is a limited resource. And that is scary because, of course, and it's high stakes. Money is the tool to afford us our options and our, you know, I don't know if money buys happiness, but certainly at a certain level, like, they've done all the studies, Princeton, Harvard, they've all done them. Like, you need to make at least, I think it's $75,000. Beyond that, you know, your happiness is not dependent on how much you make necessarily, but I think we can all agree that money does buy us important things that equate to our fulfillment and happiness, health insurance, a car that gets us to work, a roof over our head, food, all that. So that's we all agree. But I think that when we're afraid of money, there's a lot of ways it can manifest. Like, I'm afraid to face my bills because
I understand. You know, okay.
So that leads to avoidance, not looking at your bills. And then there's the fear of not having enough and never having enough, which goes back to what we were talking about, like a little bit of scarcity and scarcity mindset. And by the way, I've heard that from people at all income levels. And it's, you know, interesting to dissect that. And then there's the fear of investing because it's really volatile and uncertain, and we don't like that. We fear uncertainty. And so the fear of money is sort of it's a mix of a lot of other fears that we have. I think FOMO shows up a lot in our financial lives. Like, I'm not living and spending my money in the ways that my friends are or my family expects me to. And I feel like I'm missing out on connecting with them and experiencing the joys of life that I'm supposed to experience. And the fear of rejection, you know, asking for a raise is really scary because what if my boss says no and I don't want to feel that. So the fear of money is central to the book because it kind of bridges a lot of these other fears that we experience. And when we're talking about money, we're talking about life and all the other emotions that come with it. So to answer your question, I think that's how it manifests. But really, in so many ways, it's an opportunity when you feel this fear to do some healthy things, to remind yourself of your options when you're feeling fear, especially in your financial life. A lot of times what it's nudging you towards is to get to a place where you're feeling more secure. And sometimes what that requires is getting more educated, learning the backstory of why you are afraid, getting help, getting tools, making a plan. And so for me, like, I've been afraid of not making enough. I've been afraid of investing. In the pandemic, we bought a house. I was terrified. Like, is this the right move? It was very uncertain times. And so I did those things anyway. But knowing that the best path forward is to just listen to the fear and see if there's a way to still do that thing and address whatever fears that I was having. And so if it was the fear of investing, let's say, in 2020 when the market was tanking every day in March, I was really scared. And rather than pull out entirely, which is what sometimes the impulse is when you're afraid of that, I said, okay, let me look at my portfolio. Like, actually, what is going on? Because these drops are really big. And it turns out it's because I was very heavily exposed to the stock market. And I'm in my 40s now. I have a mortgage. I got two kids. I'm the breadwinner. I started this portfolio in my 20s when I had a much bigger appetite for risk. Should I really be like 90% invested in stocks? No. So that was good. That was a good instinct and impulse to go from feeling fear to doing a healthy action step, which was to look at what I was investing in and put it in context. And like, okay, I'm scared for a reason. So the move I made and I write about in the book was to bring dial back my stock exposure. I didn't pull out of the market entirely, but I got to a place where it was just more self-aligned. That's it, you know, and of course I'm still going to lose money in the market like when everyone else does, but maybe a little bit less. And I knew too that the less risk you take, the less reward potentially. So I don't want to end up in retirement with less money, and I want to invest less in the stock market. So how do I reconcile these two things? The answer was I have to put more of my savings into my investment fold, my investment portfolios. I have to invest more. If I was investing $100, now I have to invest $200.
Right.
But at a less aggressive rate of with less exposure to the stock market. So I'm going to grow slower, but I'm going to grow just as much over time.
Just as much. Yeah. Right. Well, I mean, to your point about like avoidance and like the fact that you're like, okay, I'm going to take a look at this and dive in and see where the issues are, see what I can change. That's a big one for me because that's something don't do. And I have a big fear. Like I get nervous to open up my bank account. I'm like, oh my God, I don't know. I don't know how much money is in there. I don't know. I don't ever know.
Odd.
It's terrible. But let me just give you a little bit of backstory on that. So I'm divorced. When I was married, my husband made most of the money. I had my own business. I still do, which fell apart during COVID, but that's another story, which I think also is a lot of my fears around money now. But we had a business manager who took care of everything. I mean, I literally never saw, you know, an electric bill. I never saw a phone bill. I never saw any bills. Everything was managed by this person who turns out after I'm divorced that he was stealing money from me. But anyway, he was a big jerk. But anyway, so I mean, not that that's an excuse. I let that happen, you know, and I was, you know, head in the sand. And I always, the narrative in my head was always, oh, I'm not good with money. I'm not good with numbers. I don't know what I'm doing. So I'm going to leave it to this person. And my husband was the same way. He really, neither of us had like a very good grasp on our finances. And we spent a lot. But anyway, so now I have this anxiety every time I go to look and see like, oh my gosh, do I have an, or if I'm paying for something in a store, I'm like, oh my God, please let that go through. Please let that go through, you know, like, and it's a terrible, terrible fear. But anyway, but I guess my, I don't know if there's a question here, but what would you tell somebody like me to kind of, dive in and work through that and look at those things and not be afraid to look at those things?
Well, I mean, going back to originally what you were saying about fearing looking at your bills and somebody else was managing them for you, I hear that a lot, you know, especially women. I've heard women who are very wealthy, independent, like they run 7-figure businesses and they say, well, I'm really good at making money. I'm really not good at managing it. So I'm allowing my husband to just manage everything. They don't even know passwords to accounts. They wouldn't even know how to write a check to the mortgage company. And yet they're very capable of making millions of dollars and they are undercutting and underestimating their ability to like look at a bill. Mm-hmm. So that's part of, I think, just the wiring as women. Sometimes we're not raised to have this like extreme confidence, you know, feeling around money.
Right.
And we do live in a patriarchy. And so a lot of times when you get into a hetero marriage, the man feels like it's his responsibility to take care of the finances. That's his domain. And the woman is maybe a, more of a, playing a supporting role or no role. So we play into a lot of these gender role expectations, and that's not good. That's dangerous. But what I would say to somebody who has fear of their capabilities with managing their money and then deferring those responsibilities to somebody else entirely and then burying their head in the sand, which is happening still, even in like within millennials and Gen Z, this is not just our grandmothers and our mothers. Like it's just, it's this thing that we're just keep carrying down. It's like this awful legacy. I'd say, okay, I get it. You're afraid. And like, I understand where that's coming from, but let me raise you something more terrifying, which is, you continue this behavior. You continue to bury your head in the sand. You allow this person to take on complete control of your financial life. And then what's the worst that might happen? Well, the worst that might happen is that they start stealing from you, or, you know, you get divorced and you have no idea where anything is. And that's more terrifying. So a lot of times when people are afraid of something in their financial life today, the trick is to think about, with leaning into this fear now and feeling stuck and doing nothing, where's that going to lead you in 5 years and 10 years? Like, I want you to go to the dark place.
Yeah.
Because that dark place, that visualization of you being penniless, broke, swindled, that should hopefully wake you up and bring you back into the present day and go, okay, I need to at least get some basics. I need to know passwords. Yeah. I need paper trails. I want to look at the numbers because I don't want this to get any worse for me. And that's, unfortunately, that's not a radical view. That's not like only a few people get cheated or swindled or lied to or end up broke because they completely deferred all their financial decision making to somebody else. That happens so often. So, you know, I think that's something you got to take really seriously, because I hear this a lot of times from women too, and I don't think that's a coincidence.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. I mean, I definitely had a rude awakening when I had to refinance my mortgage. You know, I got the apartment in the city and it was like, oh, well, how am I going to afford this now? I have to refinance. And I was like, that's when I had to take a hard look and see like, well, what does this even look like? I don't even know how to do this. I don't know, you know, and then having to go through and provide all of the stuff you have to provide to the bank when you're getting a mortgage. Right. I was like, oh, yeah. And that's when I was uncovering some things that this business manager was doing that were definitely shady. Terrible. So,
Yeah, I had Queen Latifah on my podcast once, and she talked about how when she was first starting out as a musician and artist, she deferred all of her banking and financial management to an advisor who ended up, like, there was no money left in her bank account one day, and he was not to be found. And long story short, what it taught her was, I need to be in the know. Like, I can still work with people, but I need to know. We got to talk monthly. I want to see paper trail. I'm not signing anything. I'm not giving you power of attorney over anything. Like, you're not signing my checks. I'm signing the checks. And I think that a lot of times advisors who are looking to steal, they will say, oh, well, I just want to make your life easier. Or they'll shame you. Like, you don't know how to do this. It's just like, you know, you work on your business, you work on your art, you work on your craft, I'll do me. I would be very nervous if somebody makes you feel that way or insists. I think that's not the best way forward is collaboration. You know, you need to know, because this person could also be very well intentioned, but suddenly cannot manage your money because, like, there's a life incident or their health, you know, whatever. You have to always be prepared. It could even be your partner, your spouse, that's well intentioned, but then they can't do it. And so you always need to be able to step in and take the reins.
I have different fears. I have a fear of retirement. I have a huge fear. I mean, I didn't start a 401k when I first, I've been working at my job for a good long time. I didn't start it. I started it when I got married. I got divorced. He took half of what was in there, which was not tons to begin with, but it's taken me a little while to build it. But it's like, I'm just always bad with money. Like, I'm a spender, you know, and I've been in financial debt for on and off over the years. I mean, now I'm kind of in a good place, but I really have a true fear of retiring because I think, like, how am I going to support mm-hmm. this lifestyle that I live right now. And I think a lot of people, like, I always wonder, is it ever too late? Which I don't think that it is, but I keep getting older. I'm not getting younger. So then yeah, I'm like, when does that dial become like too late? You know?
Well, I think the healthy moves for you in this place is just to, one, maybe get help. You know, this requires some number crunching and like, but first, before that, I think is really sitting down and figuring out what you want in your retirement. Yeah. You know, retirement is not a copy paste. Everyone's looks different. And maybe it's not that you retire entirely, but that there is like, is there something you would find joy in doing later in your, you know, your 60s, your 70s, even your 80s, that you can start putting the groundwork towards now. Like I was this is maybe funny, but I started talking to he's an astrologist, but he's 75 and he works out of his house in Toronto, and he's like does these Zoom consults with people who want their charts read, and I want to have my family's chart read. And I was like, this is perfect. I mean, maybe I don't think he's been doing this forever, but it probably started out as a passion. Mm-hmm. But now just through referrals, he does this. And it's not like, you know, it's supplementing probably his Social Security and whatever retirement right. he has, but he truly loves it. And it's very easy for him to do. And he can do it from home. And I'm like, maybe I need to find something like that, you know, where I can just learn something that over Zoom at 75 and make, you know, $1,000 a week or whatever doing that. Right, and then you don't have to be so fearful.
Yeah.
I mean, I would say if you're afraid, like, have you actually looked at what's going to be coming due to you in retirement? Like, if you continue to save at the pace that you are, where's that going to leave you at 65? What, you can go to the Social Security website. I know, so fun. You can go to SSA.gov. No, I know. Mm-hmm. And they'll tell you what your Social Security estimates will be at whatever age you plan to retire. And so people are usually surprised, but they're like, oh my God, I'm getting all this money. And it's not going to cover all your costs, but it could be the kind of information that would make you less afraid and more reassured of like what you're doing. And that plus Social Security is going to add up to more than you thought.
Right. I think just being informed, just to know those things.
I guess that's true of any fears that you have, you know, in a lot of these episodes of our podcast, whether it's we're talking about gut health or your mind or your brain or now money, it's like fight or flight and feeling safe. Like that, that's what it kind of everything boils down to.
Options. Yeah. My offer is, with fear, it's like you got to freeze, flight, fight. What about just figuring it out? What about just like taking a minute, doing nothing?
I know.
Sound just like my boyfriend.
I know. I was going to say.
The ironic thing is, Farnoosh, is that my boyfriend is a wealth advisor. He is a, financial
there's a lot
advisor.
Of irony
because now I do have much more of a clue, and I'm much more, it's still not, it's not great, but at least like I kind of know, I sort of, I'm like, he always tells me, what does he say? Like when you say, to saving money, he's like, it has to hurt a little. Like it just has to hurt a little when you're saving. Like it has to be a little
there's
out of
psychological,
your-
there's a lot of studies around the psychology of money. And sometimes when you, and I write about this in the book, like sometimes when you fear money, it essentially, it ignites the fear, the pain in your brain. Like it hurts, like it's painful. Yeah. And honestly, like lean into that because that, let that be a sign that like what you're doing is probably very responsible.
You're doing the right thing.
You're kind of like, and because in our financial lives, I have found when there is absolutely no friction between you and, let's say, buying something. I mean, just look at like credit cards, right? Like it's harder to use cash than credit because cash, it's like taking money out of the wallet. You see it leaving. Mm-hmm. You know it's never coming back. Credit, it's like, what is it? It's just fake money. So there's a real psychological advantage to when you create these barriers or you just like you create some extra friction in your financial life to prevent you from making impulse moves.
Yeah.
Yes.
With your money. Yes. That's healthy. That's good. Yeah. That'll keep you out of trouble.
You know, this is funny when you just said that about the credit card. So this is when I was like teenager, maybe my 20s. And they used to have the credit card machines where like you put the credit card in and you'd run it.
Oh, yeah.
Like, you'd run over.
That sounds.
Right, with the carbon, the
carbon copies. And my, my dad used to say to me, because he always thought I overspent, he's like, what you should do when you go to hand your credit card is you should stick your hand in there and let them run it over your hand so that you feel the pain of letting that money go, as opposed to, I'm like, that's a really good visual, you know, but,
totally.
But yeah, you have to feel it in order to, you know, to have that impact, I guess.
Yeah.
But I mean, so you've said in your book, like, you know, money is soulless. It's inconsequential. It's just a tool. But then like, why is there so much emotion attached to it?
That's a great question. I think it's because of, and this is going to be different for everybody, like how you feel about money. There's going to be a story there, but that's not, your story is not my story. But I think there is a story, and usually it's a story that is about, you know, again, it's like what money represents to you. A lot of times we feel like what we make represents how smart we are, how hard we worked. We tend to associate our sense of self-worth with our net worth. And that's a hard thing to face, because, and look, you know, there's so many reasons why people aren't maybe where they want to be financially. That is not their fault. Things are expensive.
Yeah.
Not,
there was a pandemic.
I mean, yeah. And also like, what you do, what you choose to do for a living to earn money is not always, you know, if you choose to be a teacher, you're not going to make the same amount of money as a stockbroker, you know, but you're choosing to do it. And not everybody can have those careers, you know.
And I was reading in New York Magazine one day about a young woman who had just come into a lot of money through her company's IPO. She was 26 years old and I think made overnight like $9 million because she was, you know, one of the first employees. It was a tech company. It made a lot of money in their IPO. And her essay was an anonymous essay. She said basically that she feels so gross and it wants to give the money back. And then as she continues to write, you really start to see where that mentality is coming from. It's because of how she was raised. And it's because of the continuing messages that she's getting around money in her life from people that are close to her, like her parents. She felt a lot of shame. She felt like this money she didn't deserve because it wasn't like she built a company. It wasn't her. But you know what? I'm like, so much of who becomes wealthy in this country is just damn luck.
It is.
It's not because they bootstrapped. It's not because they sacrificed. It's because they were lucky. They were in the right place at the right time. And that doesn't mean that you're a bad person. But nevertheless, you know, her parents were like, oh, well, you better not tell anybody that you got this money. And they were also saying things like to her, oh, now you're going to be like richer than us. That's weird. I mean, I know. And so I felt so bad for her. I wanted to first give her a hug and then also be like, you know, you making this money, look, first of all, when women make more, the world becomes a better place. Okay. Let's put that on all the I don't want anyone. Like,
it's so true.
And also, I just, if you actually knew how rich people got rich, it was an inheritance. It was working at I interviewed a woman. She and her husband, she worked at, I think, Amazon and he worked at Google or Microsoft. And they were both one of the first employees. They both became multi millionaires overnight, both of them. And it's like, what kind of luck is that? And
I know.
They didn't give it back. And I will say that they had a lot of issues to deal with their family members, people thinking that they, you know, other people in their lives were entitled to this money because this wasn't even their money, you know, it was the company's. Yeah. So look, there's always going to be a lot of BS coming at you from other people. But listen, this is not your fear. This is other people's fears.
Yeah.
And that's an important distinction. When you fear something around money in your life, a great question to ask is, where did you come from? Like, how did you show up? Is this my mother's fear from the 70s that I'm still carrying around in 2024?
That's right.
No, that's so true. No more. So
true. Yeah, you're absolutely right. Yeah. And I think, you know, other people always have an opinion on money, on what you do with your money or how you make your money. Or it's like, it's none of your business, you know?
No.
And these people that fall into these great situations, good for them.
I agree.
You know, I mean, I think.
I agree.
I just hope, I said, you know, if part of you feels, I mean, I get it. So, sometimes you're like, I have more than enough. I don't want more. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, I don't know. I'm not going to
Does anyone say that?
I know.
Does anyone say that they don't want more?
Rachel Ray, I remember I was reading an article about her years ago, and, you know, she's a very, very wealthy woman. She also works extremely hard, and I think the article was about how she, from all the money that she makes, she donates a lot. And she's like, I keep what I need and want, and then but I give away a lot, because for me, it's like, what do I need $20, $30 million a year for? Yeah. Like, I don't have kids, I have pets, I have a husband, but like, we don't, because of her lifestyle. And that's not to say that everyone else should do as Rachel Ray does and that she's like more righteous or virtuous, but like, she's decided for herself what is enough. And that's an important, I mean, I'd love for us all to think more critically about that, because it can feel a lot of times where you're just this hamster on a wheel. It's never enough. As soon as you make more, you spend more, and then you need more. And then it just becomes this, like, really this burnout ultimately. Yeah. And you wake up one day and you're like, I have a lot, but I don't feel wealthy.
Fulfilled.
I don't feel
like, what
rich.
Is that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, I think, you know, to your point, there are different types of people, right? The people, I mean, you can have two people that are making the same amount of money. Let's say it's, you know, Rachel Ray kind of money, but they have the attitude of more, 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 whereas she has this attitude of being so generous. And I will say, I know firsthand that she's very generous.
Yes.
Extremely.
Yeah.
I mean, find content in your financial life. I mean, I wish that for everybody. I think it's really especially hard for people who do get to become very wealthy, because then part of what they feel is like their sense of self-worth, again, is their net worth, right?
Yeah.
And, and I see this a lot in the entrepreneur world, where you're only as successful as your previous year if you made more money. Right. And I've gotten to a point in my life where, I'm not going to if someone wants to give me more money, that's great. But if it requires more time out of my day to go and do all these things to make more, just to make more so that I can feel successful on paper, no, because right now what I value a lot more than making extra money is getting my time back.
Time.
And I have to make a certain amount of money to maintain our lifestyle. Beyond that, it's going to become a real question of like, is it going to be worth it? What's it going to take? And it's not always a yes.
Yeah. But don't you think, though, when you get to a certain point, you know, when you've achieved this financial success like you have, that you can kind of pick and choose those things, right?
Yes.
Like, you have the freedom
to pick and
choose. That's the reward.
That's the reward. That's why we do it. We do it to earn the options that we want in life. And sometimes the option is to not do something that you've had to feel like you have had to do.
Right.
It gives us a permission to say, no, I'm not going to do it that way. I'm going to do things my way, or I'm going to leave, or I'm going to, you know, invest in different ways and donate. That is the best, you know, when you can use your money. That's what we do it for.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we need to constantly remind ourselves of that, because I know also people who save just to save. And then they are afraid to take a vacation, or they don't know, like, when they really do need the money, because maybe they lost their jobs or their car broke down or they have a health crisis and they got to pay medical bills out of pocket. They're like, ooh, I got to step into savings. Like, good job.
That's what it's for.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
This is what it was for.
It's funny.
You did the job.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's funny because Regis Philbin always used to say, you know, he was raised in that kind of depression era in the 30s. And so they were poor. And his mom, you know, he used to say that's on the show, but I know it's something he really believed, was that it's like, hey, Mr. Big Shot, his mom always used to say, hey, Mr. Big Shot, the poorhouse is just around the corner. Like, he had that feeling that everything that he had achieved
could be taken away
in an instant. And so he, you know, held on to his money pretty well, I should say, but may he rest in peace. But It's just interesting, that mentality, like what you're saying. It's like to hold on because you're afraid.
Well, that's scarcity. That's definitely scarcity mentality, right? When you say like you have that scarcity mindset of it could be gone at any moment.
Right.
Which isn't necessarily a bad thing. Like, I don't know. I feel like it's a little bit of a motivator to keep, I don't know. But I'm also somebody who's like constantly looking for that next thing and how to make more money. There was something that I thought was so interesting. I actually wrote it down because I knew I was going to forget this. It was a scientific study in The Behavioral Economist about loss aversion. And you wrote about this, I think. A real or psychological loss is more painful than the joy of a gain of that same amount.
You know.
I want to understand that better. Like, it's, is that true? I mean, I guess it's true to an extent.
I think because I hear that. And then I also remember a statistic I heard just yesterday that only 25% of us are born optimists, that the default as humans is to be pessimistic. It doesn't mean that we can't learn to be optimistic. My friend is actually, Dr. Sue Varma is coming out with a book. You should have her on your podcast. It's called Practical Optimism. And she told me this actually. So I think it's what it's really telling us is that as humans, our default is to just be, we're more affected by the losses in life, whether and you know, or the you know, the failures and not appreciate the wins as much. I mean, at a very simplistic level, look at Yelp, okay? When you have a great experience at a restaurant, do you go on Yelp and shout about it? No, but if you have a bad waiter or your meal was disgusting or they never served, like you're writing about it. Yeah, and so like that's the other end of it too. Like we talk more also about the things that didn't work out as opposed to the things that did.
Yes.
Yeah.
And this is important to know about our, ourselves because really it's important to, you have to be proactive about remembering who you really are, which is far more than just your failures. It's actually, there are way more successes. I see this in the stock market too. You know, people obsess over, well, the stock market is so volatile, it's so risky, you lose money. Yes. But did you know that there are more periods of gains than there are losses in the stock market? That, well, we had a recession in 2008, it lasted, you know, the stock market declined for 2 years and then it went up for 11 years. Wow. And that wasn't just a snapshot in time. That's the trend. And yet we just have this fixation on the loss. And so it goes back to that study in my book and that loss aversion. It's just an interesting, again, so much of how we manage our money comes down to the psychology of who we are and knowing that, understanding that. It's not to say that we're just doomed. It's just like, oh, that's interesting. Let me try to offset that.
Yeah.
By just being more conscious, by switching my mind.
Being aware.
And just being aware, right, of, of the truth.
Yeah. Just knowing the truth.
You also talk about in your book what it means to be rich, right? And that it has less to do with the accumulation of money. Can you explain that a little bit more?
Yeah, I love this conversation. It's so important because, again, we equate so much of what financial success is to numbers and what's, what our bank statements are telling us. And, of course, there's a degree of that. Like, I think, you, again, we all need a baseline of income and money to just sort of feel like we can afford the basics. And beyond that, though, there are so many other assets that we have that constitute wealth. So it's your access to all the resources that we have in America too, that most people don't in the world, whether that's running water, Wi-Fi, good schools. This is the sort of stuff that is invaluable. And also in your personal life, your relationships, your health, your mind, your can-do-itness, your ambition, all of these things, I call it these invaluable assets that are especially important to remember during periods where you're fearing uncertainty. Mm-hmm. Yeah, uncertainty is the only certainty in life. Right. What are the certainties in your life that are unshakable, that even if you lost your job tomorrow, you'd still have these assets that you could leverage? I've lost my job more than once. And most famously, it was during the Great Recession. And I went on the Today Show to talk about it right away. My agent was like, please don't do that. I know. I was like, no, I want to show the people that I am one with the people. Exactly. I am like you. My mother lost her job. I've lost my job. You know, like, I think it's important to talk about, to bring yourself into the discourse. And, but so that's why I say it was like a famous layoff. But it was like, I was devastated, you know, I thought, who am I? I don't have a title anymore. I don't have a job. I don't have a salary. I don't have income. And then I was like, but wait a minute. I have a body of work. I have relationships. I have written a book that I didn't get laid off from. And so I think I have some things to work with here that, you know, I'm not saying it's going to work around and turn around for me overnight, but it definitely gave me the confidence. And it allowed me to relax the fear a little bit to know that, like, I'm going to be okay because I have assets I can leverage and I'm still somebody. And maybe, again, I don't have – we associate so much of who we are and our sense of self-worth to things like titles. And by the way, during the recession, it was much easier for, I think, women to kind of bounce back because we don't have that same attachment to titles and salary because, first of all, we're newer to the work field. So we're just not conditioned as much as men to source so much of our sense of ego to, like, our senior titles or our, you know, C-suite titles or whatever. And so it was harder for men to bounce back because they were trying to basically go back to exactly what they had. You know, I lost my job as chief communications officer at a bank. I want another chief communications officer role. With this, you know, whereas, like, I was like, I'll just do 13 jobs until I can make ends meet.
Exactly.
Yeah.
See which. Yeah, I think women are much more able to reinvent themselves, like to look at a situation. They go to their friends, they look around, and they were like, okay, how can I change this for myself? Yeah. I think that women are much more.
Yeah, I think
to do that.
I think that also kind of speaks to, like, entrepreneurship versus, you know, having a salaried job and what that is like. I mean, I've been on both sides of it, and I'm just curious to get your thoughts on that. Like, you know, do you think people regret not like somebody who's, let's say, they're CEO of a company and they're doing really well and they're successful and all that, but are there regrets that they're not doing something of their own? And that, I don't know.
I mean, financial FOMO, career FOMO, I write about that in the book. It's, again, universal. Mm-hmm. And there's always a shiny object over there that you're not acquiring. In those moments, I think it's really important to get clear on not just, like, the things that you want or the titles you want or the roles that you want, but, like, what is it that you want to learn? What is it that you want to experience? What are the feelings that you want to have at the end of your day? What is the impact that you want to create in the world? And if the job, the career that you have is not lining up to that, then I think there's, like, an opportunity there to shift. But, you know, don't fool yourself to think that just because someone else is doing something different and they're happy that you're missing out. Mm-hmm. Again, this is human nature, and I don't think social media helps with this.
It definitely hurts it. You definitely you have to take what you see with a grain of salt because everyone's curating what they want you to see about how great their life is.
Performance, as my friend said the other day. I was like, that's true.
I mean, and I think everything's relative, and you just have to, you know, be grateful. I mean, it's all about being grateful for what you have
right. Like, I guess what I struggle with is, you know, in this entrepreneur role that I've had now for 20 plus years, and it's had major ups and downs, and it's been on a very strong down for, you know, since the pandemic. But so in my mind, I always think, like, oh, should I go and look for, like, a job where I actually have a salary and I have benefits? And so I'm always playing this game with myself. But then I think about, you know, the real benefits I have of being my own boss and the flexibility and the freedom. And it's like, I can always, you know.
Well, we're two sides of the same coin. I have a job that dictates a lot of my time. Yeah. It takes a lot of my time. It takes a lot of my effort, even when, you know, the show, it's more than just 9 to 10 a.m. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a lot more than, and I look at a lot of the free time that you have. And the
she's always asking me, what are you doing right now?
I know. And I'm like, I'm in a meeting. What are you doing?
What are you doing? I'm like, none of your business what I'm doing.
But
yeah, and honestly, these are healthy. There's a healthiness to this. You know, I think what I'm hearing is that you're curious, and that curiosity is leading you to kind of look at, well, what could be on the other side, and looking at that really analytically is never a bad thing. But the mistake is when we make these impulse moves, we internalize. Mm-hmm. And we say, oh, well, they're doing something different, which means what I'm doing is wrong. That's where we get into trouble. But I always like keeping options open. And I mean, just as I've been running my business since 2009, since that layoff. But over the years, I've gone back into corporate, you know, and come out. I feel like you got to always leave your options open. Mm-hmm. And during the pandemic, I got an incredible offer to go in-house at a media company and be editor at large. And, you know, at the time, I was like, that's what I need. I'm a little afraid of running this business during the pandemic. I don't know. And I got a mortgage now with a lot of responsibilities. The idea of having stable income is music to my ears. So I did that. And now I don't do that. But it was like, I think you just have to meet these opportunities and make sure that you're approaching them from a place of real need, and always knowing that when you make a choice, you can make another choice after that, that nothing is locked or fixed.
Yeah. Nothing is.
That's such a good, that's a good point.
That's amazing.
This is so good.
Thank you so much. Like, I feel like we've gotten like a pep talk.
And my wheels are spinning now. Yeah. There's so many things.
I mean, is there some last, we know you have to go, but is there some last advice that you would give someone, like something easy that someone could do to start getting over whatever fear they have of money, or even just like financial advice that you would give them to like get started on a road, you know?
So many things, but really I just want people to know that when they feel fear in any realm of their life, that it's completely normal. It's not a sign of cowardice or weakness. And if anything, if you want to reflect on this fear of yours and how it may have even helped you in your life, giving it some credit, I think is not something we've ever done. But I think we'll be really surprised in a good way, and let it just be a sign that when you feel fear, you know, there may be an opportunity there for growth, for learning, for seeking help, for going back in time and remembering all the crazy things your parents told you. And, you know, I like this book for me was the hardest book I ever wrote, but also so joyful. And I try to make it light and fun, you know, come for the advice, but stay for the stories.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And
yeah, the stories are great. And I love the title.
I love the title. The title is A Healthy State of Panic. Our guest today was Farnoosh Torabi. Thank you so much
for being here and taking the time.
This is amazing. All right. So what do you think of that? Do you feel less fearful about money? How do you feel? Are you going to look at your bank account? Like what's happening?
Such a weird, like, anxiety-producing thing that I have. That was helpful in, like, sort of recognizing what my fears are, you know, and just diving in. Like she said, like, she just took a look at her investments, and she made changes. And it's like, okay, well.
It's kind of like to be brave enough to look at it. I mean, it's like, you know, Tim is always telling me, for me, it's like, well, how much do you need? How much do you spend? Right. What are you going to spend on? Yeah. Take a look. Like, really do things. Like, ask for help. You know, be aware.
Point about, like, retirement is, like, look at what your spending is now.
Right.
And how much you're going to need in retirement to keep up the lifestyle that you have. And it's like, can you do that? The one thing I wanted to get to, and we didn't have time, but, like, budgeting.
Oh,
and,
I know.
You know, setting a budget for yourself. And that's another thing that I get so freaked out about. I've done it too. And I've made spreadsheets, and then I'm like, oh, I don't want to look at that. I'm outside of my budget. Exactly. I know I'm spending more.
I'm already out.
Yeah.
That asymmetrical dress you just bought is already out of your budget.
Everything I buy is out of my budget.
Totally. Everything you buy is out of everyone's budget.
Talk about living beyond your means.
Oh my God.
No, but she was great.
It's good to hear about a different topic that we really haven't talked about.
We haven't talked about yet. Yeah. So I hope you guys enjoyed that.
Yeah, we did for sure.
Her book is called A Healthy State of Panic.
Right. And you should listen Farnoosh to it, Torabi. Buy it.
Yeah, I listened to it.
Get over your fears.
Get over your fears.
I'm Lori Schulweis.
And I'm Jen Giamo.
And this was Every.Body Talks.
Talk to you next time. For more information about our podcast, to learn more about us, and to catch up on all of our episodes, go to our website at everybodytalkspodcast.com.
Follow us on Instagram at Shalit, at Jen Giamo, and at Everybody Talks. And if you want to watch today's episode, go to our YouTube channel at Everybody Talks Podcast.
Join the Everybody Talks community by checking out our Facebook page where you can ask questions, post comments, and be part of the conversation.
And don't forget, if you like what you've heard, give us a 5-star rating, write a review, and tell a friend. We're for everybody and everybody. The Everybody Talks podcast is co-created, executive produced, and hosted by us, Lori Schulweis and Jen Giamo. Produced and edited by Eric Jackowitz.
Our theme song music is written and performed by Jackie Ryle and Aaron Navizi, with additional support from our pups, Oliver, Milo, and Murray.
Talk to you next time.